Just your gut feeling, that is what I'm asking. Don't write in the chat. I cannot see the chat actually because I'm. All right. In any case, if you don't want to commit to some answer, I hope you will agree that you should not be using the thing on the right hand side of the screen. Okay, because and we have this gut feeling built in ourselves. Even if you don't want to answer that, it is somehow there. Okay, so this is our feeling that whatever transparent thing we are having, we have never seen that to be conducting. And whatever conducting thing we know, for example, copper wire or any kind of metal, metals are generally conducting, and we never see transparent metals. So that is why these are two contradictory properties, this transparency and this conductance. And I will just explain you that why these are two contradictory properties. First, I will show you that if the material is transparent, we expect it to be insulator. And if the material is metal, we expect it to be shiny. Okay. So what is the basic physics behind that? That is what we are going to explore in coming few slides. And that is the basic physics behind all this problem. So as I said, that we expect the insulators to be transparent. And why that is the case? Because if light has to travel through some material, it should not interact with that material. Not interacting means light should not get absorbed, it should not get scattered. Then only it can pass through any material, and we can call that material as transparent. And what is the energy of the light photons? I hope you can work it out for yourself. This energy, the wavelength, I hope you know that the wavelength of the visible light varies from 400 nanometers to 800 nanometers. That is the approximate range. And if you convert it into electron volts, it turns out that the energy of the photons is varying from 1.5 electron volt to 3 electron volts. So if in your material you want that such that photon of this particular energy should not get absorbed, okay, then what should happen is that whatever material you are having, it should have some band gap, and that band gap should be greater than 3 electron volts. Because if it is less than 3 electron volts, then what will happen is that the photon can get absorbed, and it can excite an electron from the valence band to the empty conduction band. Okay. So that is why I said that what we expect is that whatever transparent material we are having, they should be having a band gap greater than 3 electron volts. That means that the material should be either insulator or it should be a wide band gap. And in any case, its band gap has to be greater than 3 electron volts. So that is one part of the problem, as I explained, that why we expect these insulators, the transparent materials, to be insulators. Next, we will discuss a few things. There will be a few equations. I hope you don't get scared by those equations. But I thought that it will be appropriate for the MSc students. So let us discuss about some optical properties of metals. I hope you know that light is basically electromagnetic radiation. And when the electromagnetic radiation is passing through these materials, either be conducting or they can be insulating in nature. In any case, we have this complex index of refraction. You must have studied some index of refraction in your plus two or maybe in high school also. And that index of refraction is actually the small n. Okay? That is the real part of this complex index of refraction. There is another imaginary, purely imaginary part of the complex index of refraction, and that accounts for the damping inside the material. If you do not have any real part, the whole part is, if it is only imaginary, then your wave will not travel inside the material. Okay, because it will get damped very soon. And similar to complex index of refraction, you can also define complex dielectric function, which again has some real and imaginary part. And these two, these n and epsilon, have a relation that they are, that this epsilon is the square root of n. And why all these things are necessary? Because if you have taken any course on electromagnetism or solid state physics, and if you have studied about the optical properties of metal, then you will come to know that the electric field inside the metal is given by this particular equation. In this equation, what you can do is you can replace this n by square root of epsilon, again, you don't have to worry too much about all those equations. Even if you are not familiar with all these things, then also it's okay, because our final result is rather easy to understand. But I am just showing that how we are arriving at that particular result. Okay, and if we assume that the collision, if we neglect the collision of the electrons with the ions, then we get this classical result. I'm sorry, someone wants to ask anything? So if we neglect this collision of electrons with the ions, then we get this classical relation that this epsilon is equal to 1 minus omega p over omega square, where this omega p is very, very important. It is known as the plasma frequency. I will just tell you that what is the physical significance of this plasma frequency. This plasma frequency tells us that up to what frequency the metal will act like opaque material. For example, the electromagnetic wave cannot travel inside the material. Okay, that threshold frequency is known as the plasma frequency. If your electromagnetic radiation has frequency greater than the plasma frequency, then the wave can travel inside your material. And what happens in case of metals is, I will just skip this part. What happens in case of metals is that this plasma frequency lies in the UV range. And as I said, what that means is that whatever frequency is equal to or below this particular range, all of that, because it cannot get transmitted inside the material, it can only get reflected from the material. Therefore, these frequencies get reflected from the material. And metals will be transparent for frequencies greater than the plasma frequency. So this concept of plasma frequency is very important, because when we are designing these transparent conducting oxides, then this plasma frequency we have to keep in mind. Okay, and what you have to keep in mind here is that on what factors this plasma frequency depends. This plasma frequency depends upon square root of n and square root of mass of the electron. Now you might say that why I am talking about the mass of the electron, it is just a constant value. But in case of solids, again, if you have had any course on solid state physics, then you must be knowing that the electrons inside the solids, as far as conductors are concerned, they behave almost like free electrons. But there is one critical thing that you need to keep in mind, that instead of their actual mass, you should replace it with the effective mass of the electron. And similarly, in this case also, for plasma frequency also, you should replace it with the effective mass of the electron. So here, effective mass may not be such a critical issue, but the main issue here is N, the electron density of free electrons, the density of free electrons. How many electrons are there? How many free electrons are there per unit volume? And by free electron, I obviously mean the electrons which are there in the conduction band, because the electrons in the valence band, they do not contribute to, if the valence band is completely filled, they do not contribute to any kind of electricity. So this you have to keep in mind. Okay, and as I explained, that this is also the reason why metals are so shiny, because whatever visible light is falling on these metals, all that light gets reflected due to the fact that the plasma frequency is lying in the UV region. So how to make transparent conductors? Okay, one thing can be that you start from conductor and you make that transparent. Okay, for example, you can take metals and you can try to make them transparent. And what, how can we make them transparent? You have to shift your plasma frequency from the UV region to the IR region, so that only till IR region waves are reflected, and as soon as you enter the optical range of 1.5 to 3 electron volts, in that range your photons can pass through inside the material. Okay, but the problem with metals is that you cannot change the value of them. You cannot change the carrier concentration inside the metals. That is kind of fixed. So therefore, it makes it almost impossible to make these metals transparent. Another route is that you start from transparent material and make that conductive. Okay, so what you have to do in that particular case is, how to make these transparent materials to be conducting? You have to introduce some kind of doping inside your material. Okay, but that doping has to be optimum doping, because if you increase the doping too much, then your plasma frequency will get shifted towards higher and higher end energy, and then that energy can enter in the visible region, and then your material will no longer be conductive. Therefore, you do not have too much liberty there also, that you can introduce conductivity, but up till some point, so that the plasma frequency is still below the visible region. Okay. So that is what I have followed, and that is what almost everyone is following, that route. That we are starting from some transparent wide band gap semiconductor. We are doping some charge carriers inside that transparent insulator or wide band gap semiconductor, and then we are looking for conductivity. But to be used as transparent conducting oxides, their conductivity should be of the order of milliohm centimeter, and their transparency should be greater than 80%. Those are the two minimum criteria that should be satisfied by these materials, so that they can be classified as transparent conductors. Now, there is already some existing TCM. Obviously, you are seeing these flat screen displays, you are seeing the touch screens and all those things. That means there is some existing TCM, and that TCO is indium tin oxide. It is the best known TCO that exists at present. Okay, but if it has the best properties, all the properties that we want, then why we want to have new TCOs? Why we are looking for new TCOs? Now, these new TCOs are important because first is that this ITO is expensive. It uses indium. Indium is not found easily in earth, okay, and therefore that makes it expensive. That is one problem. But even if it were not so expensive, then also we require new TCOs, because whenever you are looking to make devices of different structures, what you want is that when you are growing device on some kind of a substrate, okay, then that substrate and your device should have the same structure. Therefore, you require TCOs of different structures, and that is why we are working on SRS-03. So, before going forward, if anyone has any question, I'll stop for 1 minute, maybe.
Participants, if you want to ask anything, please, you can directly ask to Dr. Abhinav sir.
Yeah, you can just switch on your mic and you can ask if you have anything.
I think sir, we can. Second question is there. What is perovskites?
I'll describe that. Yeah, I'll describe. Okay. So related to the question that has been asked, that what is perovskite? I will discuss SRSNO3, and it has a perovskite structure. So perovskite is basically a structure, and why it is called the perovskite structure is because of this CaTiO3. The CaTiO3 mineral was discovered by this Russian mineralogist Perovsky, and this CaTiO3 has this structure, as you can see here. Its general formula is AbO3. Is the cursor visible to you all? Can you see the cursor?
Yes sir.
Okay. All right. So this AbO3 is the general structure, and as you can see that in case of CaTiO3, A is calcium, B is titanium, and O3. And what this structure is, that you have your A ion somewhere in between, then you have this kind of a cube, okay, and at the edges you have this B cation. Okay, and that B cation is surrounded by 6 oxygen ions. Okay, and the solid structure that these 6 oxygen ions are forming, that is known as the octahedron. Okay, I hope you know octa stands for 8. It has 8 sides, therefore it is called as an octahedra. So this is why it is known as this structure is known as the perovskite structure, based on the name of the Russian mineralogist who found it first. Okay. Now, why these perovskite structures are important? SRSNO3, by the way, also has the same perovskite structure. And why we are worried about these perovskites? These perovskites have amazing properties. They are insulators, metallic, magnetic, superconducting. All kinds of conductivity is there. All kind of magnetic structure is there. They are paramagnetic, they are insulating, they are antiferromagnetic, ferromagnetic. Okay, so any kind of property that you want, most probably you can find that inside these perovskite structured materials. And because they show such diverse properties, they have many applications, some of which are listed over here. Okay, and as I told you before, that if you want to make devices out of these perovskite structured materials, your base, your electrode should also have the same structure, so that your device has minimum defects. Because I hope you know this, that whenever you have defects inside your device, it degrades the properties of that particular device. Okay, so that is why we want that. Now we will discuss about the design principle. That what we want actually is, we want a high carrier concentration. The charge carrier concentration should be high enough. Obviously not so high that the plasma frequency goes to that region of visible light. And your charge carriers should have high mobility so that the devices can perform well. Now from band theory, what we know is that if your band structure has large dispersion, then its effective mass will be lower. And what kind of orbitals have largest dispersion? Those are the s orbitals. So what we ideally want is that our conduction band should be composed of the s orbitals. And due to this particular requirement, there are several candidates for the cation. What we want is, because we are talking about conduction band, which are the unoccupied orbitals, we want our s orbitals to be unoccupied. That means there should be no electron in those s orbitals. And there are several such cations, some of which are listed over here. And you can see here we have this tin in fourth charge state.
Okay. Excuse me, sir. Yes. There is one more question. That yes. How perovskites show such diverse properties?
Okay. It is difficult to answer actually this question. But generally, what happens here is that in metals, what happens is that the electrons are behaving almost like free particles. Okay, but as you know, yes.
So we can say it's observation, like experimental data shows like they are showing these properties.
No, I'm just giving one example.
Okay.
So what happens here is that because in metals the electrons are behaving almost like free particles, and if you read Kittel's book, then in that book it is explained that why the electrons do not feel each other's presence. They are not repelled by the Coulomb repulsion as much as they should be repelled. Okay, so therefore that is the reason why they behave like free particles. What happens in case of perovskites is that these particles, these electrons, do feel each other's presence. Okay, and there are many competing phenomena which are going inside these perovskite materials. And if you tune one property of these electronic correlations slightly, it can change the properties very drastically. Okay, so it is a delicate balance. Okay, and whichever, if you give it a slight nudge in one direction, it changes the properties of the material drastically. So that is a general answer to the question that has been asked, that why perovskites show such wide range of properties. It is due to these competing phenomena. Okay. Now I am not sure whether it is a satisfying answer for whoever asked that question, but it is, because it was a general question, this is the general answer for that question. That is the reason. But you have to go into the details of a particular compound, why it shows magnetic order or superconductivity or whatever. Okay. So as I said, that I will be showing some work on SRSNO3. So these are some properties that I have listed for SRSNO3. First one is that its structure is a distorted perovskite structure. What do I mean by distorted perovskite structure is something like this, that if you look at this particular structure, it looks like this angle from this particular ion to this particular ion. This whole angle looks like 180 degree. But in case of SRSNO3, it is not 180 degree, but it is around 160 degree. So it is as if you have taken these periscites and you have tilted them, you have rotated them. Okay, that disturbs these angles. So that is what is meant by a distorted structure. It has a distorted structure. It has a wide band gap, which is approximately 4 electron volts, which is very good for our work. And it has some other properties, which I am not going into. But one of the important property here is that the high dielectric constant. This is always good for perovskite, transparent conducting oxides. It has many uses. Again, I am not going into those uses because I am not working in that particular field. I will be only focusing that how to make or how we were successful in making this as transparent conducting oxide. So here is this one big problem with SRSNO3. As I told you that it has a distorted perovskite structure. And whenever you have distortion inside your solid, it always leads to scattering of the charge carriers, which reduces the mobility of the charge carriers and it degrades its electrical properties. Another problem with this perovskite structure is, this distorted structure is that this kind of distortion also leads to scattering of light. And that we don't want, because as I said before, that what we want in our transparent material is that it should not scatter light, because if it scatters light, then it will lose its transparency. Okay, now the transparency is not completely lost due to the distortion, but it leads to some absorption of or some scattering of light. Okay, and I will show you that just by tuning this distortion, this tilting of the octahedra, even by slightly, that can make a huge change to its electrical properties. And that is what we have observed. Okay, so I think let me discuss very briefly about the experimental techniques. I will try to finish it in maybe 5-10 minutes so that then I can discuss about the work. So what experimental techniques we are using and why we use experimental techniques is because these materials are very, very small. You cannot see inside the atom. You cannot make experiments inside the atom. You require some sophisticated experimental techniques to know about the material that you have created or devised. Okay, so some of the techniques are obviously, I hope all of you have seen this Bragg's law for diffraction, okay, which is written at the bottom as well, 2d sin theta equal to n lambda. And what this XRD does is that it gives you, it looks something like this, as you can see that there are some discrete peaks, mostly the intensity is zero, and you get these sharp peaks at some certain values of 2 theta. And what these what information is contained in this peak is that if you are looking only at the 2 theta value, it tells you about the shape and size of the unit cell. And if you model its intensity, then it can tell you that what atoms are present at what sites inside your unit cell. So you get the whole information about your structure from the XRD pattern. So there are several uses of XRD. As I said, I'll go a little faster. Another technique that we are using is UV visible spectroscopy. What we do in UV visible spectroscopy is that we have our material, we incident photon on it of different energies. Energies ranging from visible light to UV visible range. Okay, and what happens is when you incident those photons, then what happens is that electron make a transition from the valence band to the conduction band. Okay, if you are familiar with the concept of excitons, then you know that there are some exciton levels at the bottom of the conduction band. Not the bottom of the conduction band actually, but it is below the conduction band. Okay. And all these informations about the band gap and these exciton levels, all these information can be obtained from UV visible spectra. Okay. And both these figures are taken from Kittel's book. If you want, you can read from that particular book. And this UV visible spectroscopy, it not only gives you exciton levels, band gap, but it gives you the optical properties and film thickness also. Okay, so but you have to maybe go to NIR region for calculation of different properties. Another spectroscopy technique that we are using is the Raman spectroscopy. So in case of Raman spectroscopy, it is basically incoherent scattering of light. You have some light incident on your material, which has some discrete energy levels, and if your material has been left to some excited state. If this was your initial state where your system was in this particular state, but after the scattering it is in some higher energy excited state, then what will happen is that your scattered photon will have a frequency which will be less than the frequency of the incident photon. This is basically conservation of energy. So such kind of lines that we get are known as Stokes lines. The opposite can also happen. Instead of starting from ground state, ending in the excited state, you can start from excited state and end in the ground state. In that case, what will happen is that your scattered photon will have a frequency which will be larger than the incident frequency. These lines are known as the anti-Stokes lines. And as an example, this is the Raman spectra of zirconia, okay, where you can see that these are your anti-Stokes lines and these are your Stokes lines. Again, Raman has a lot of information contained in it because it is related to the vibrations of the solid. Therefore, it gives you a lot of information about the structure of the solid. There are many other uses of Raman spectroscopy, some of which are listed. Maybe I can skip this part because I want to just spend some time with whatever work we have done. Okay. So if anyone wants to know, then maybe I can discuss those things with you. Okay. Otherwise, I will just skip this part and I want to spend some part at whatever work we have done. I will just show these techniques later on, that how we have used these techniques and what kind of information we have derived from these techniques. Okay, I can spend 1 or 2 minutes here because this is important. This technique is known as the X-ray photo emission spectroscopy, XPS. In this technique, what happens is that you have this solid, you have some states below, and what happens is that when you incident some X-rays on it, then what happens is that this electron makes a transition to some unoccupied state. It can actually, in case of XPS, what happens is that this electron goes above the vacuum level. That means it becomes free. It comes out of the material and you check its kinetic energy. Okay, so that kinetic energy is given as whatever was the energy of the photon that you incident minus whatever was the binding energy. So you can see that the kinetic energy that you get is related to the negative of the binding energy. So it gives you information about the binding energy inside the solid. When it is coming out of the solid, what can happen is that in the first case, you can see that it has just got scattered from somewhere else and you got, so this is kind of an elastic scattering. The kinetic energy does not change. But what another thing that can happen is that whenever it is getting scattered, it can excite that sea of electrons. Whatever free electrons are there, they can start oscillating like plasma. So those kind of oscillations are known as plasmon oscillations. And these oscillations can be observed in case of XPS, and it tells you that your material has free electrons inside it. So these kind of plasma oscillations you can see in case of XPS. So I will just skip this part, and there are again several uses of XPS, some of which are listed over here. Okay. So I will again maybe stop for 1 minute if someone has any question, otherwise I will continue.
Participants, if you want to ask something, please, you can directly interact with Dr. Abhinav sir. Okay. I guess there is no question, sir.
Yeah, so let us continue with this lanthanum doped SRSNO3, the material that we have been studying. What we have done is we have taken SRSNO3 in its pristine form. It is not such a good transparent conducting oxide. So what we did was we doped it with lanthanum. Okay, and there have been several previously theoretical studies that whether lanthanum can be a good dopant in SRSNO3 or not. Okay, so we have that was the motivation that why we have chosen lanthanum as our dopant in case of SRSNO3. So these are just some experimental details. You can read the paper. I will give you the references at the end of the presentation where you can see all these things. Okay, in more detail. I will just show you that how we are getting information, how we are extracting information from all these experimental techniques about the material that we are using. So first technique that we have used here is XRD. In case of XRD, I told you that you get the complete picture of the structure, where your atom is present, at what position, what are the various angles, what are the bond angles. And to do all those things, to do that kind of thing, what you have to do is you have to refine your structure. And that refinement is known as Rydberg refinement. So that is the refinement that we have done, and it is shown over here. And from after that refinement, this is the structure that we got. And if you compare this structure with the CaTiO3 structure, which I think was somewhere here, from this structure, okay, then you can see that our LaSrSnO3 structure is actually a distorted structure. You can see the distortions here. Okay, and we got a numerical estimate for these distortions. So as I said, that there are many properties that you can get here. You can see that we got Sr strontium oxide distances, we got bond lengths, SNO bond lengths we got, and we calculated this average tilt angle also. Okay, in this case you can see that this distance Sr and oxygen distance, this distance actually increases with lanthanum doping, whereas SN and oxygen bond length, that actually decreases with doping. And what is happening to the average tilt angle? This average tilt angle is decreasing with lanthanum doping, as you can see over here. Okay, and as you will see that this difference, this even slight difference in the tilt angle, as you can see that the 7% doping, the tilt angle is actually only 1 degree. Now you may say that 1 degree is a very, very small angle, but you will see that what even such small changes in the structure, how they lead to such drastic changes in the conduction properties. And this is actually related to the previous question also, that why perovskites show such diverse properties. Because even if you change in this structure, for example, in this case tilt angle, even if you change that very slightly, it leads to a drastic change in the observed properties. So to that we will come later on, but these are some of the results we got from XRD. Okay, and the main thing here to notice is that there was a decrease in the SNO bond length, average bond length, and there was an increase in the average strontium oxide bond length. But the change in the unit cell volume was negligible. And what does that mean? What does all this mean? Some bonds are getting stressed, some bonds are getting compressed, but still the unit cell volume is the same. It actually means, and we will support this with further experiments, that these distortion, the rotation, the tilting of the octahedra, that is moving more and more towards 180 degree. That means that tilting is reducing. And if you want to reduce the tilting, you don't have to change the volume. Okay, and the volume remains conserved, and still you can reduce the tilting. And what we expected due to the reduction in the tilting was that we expected an increase in the bandwidth and a decrease in the band gap.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, there is one question related to XRD. That mostly XRD first peak observed in between 30 to 40 degrees. Why? Mm-hmm.
30 to 40 degree first peak, it is that is not the case. That is actually not the case, as you can see that there is this peak 110 peak also. Okay, it is you can actually calculate. It depends upon the lattice parameters. Actually, lattice parameters are generally of the order of 3 angstrom, right? So maybe I can write something here. Is it visible? Is the screen visible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so if I write this 2d sine theta equal to n lambda, right, we always do, what we do is we put this n is equal to 1. Okay, and because theta is very, very small in terms of radian, you can write it approximately equal to theta. So you will see that theta is approximately equal to lambda over 2d, and because we are calculating 2 theta, so this would imply that 2 theta will be approximately equal to lambda over d. Now lambda is what? 1.54 angstrom. Let us take d to be around 3 angstrom. Okay, so you can see that this would imply that 2 theta will be approximately given as 0.5. Okay, so actually whatever values we are getting, it is due to this interplay between lambda and d. This is what determines that where you will observe your peaks. Okay, it depends upon the value of d. Now this does not give you the answer that why it is lying between 30 and 40, obviously, but you have to go to a particular solid because it is not 3 angstrom, it is generally greater than 3 angstrom. Okay, so it can be 3.2, 3.5 or something like that. Okay, so you can use that relation to arrive at your answer that why generally it is between 30 and 40. Actually that is obviously not the case, but that is an approximate answer. Actually it is not approximate, I'm sorry, it is the exact answer. You'll get the exact values from there.
Yes sir, he's satisfied.
Yeah, all right. So what we did was we performed these exacts calculations and in this exacts measurements, and what happens in this exacts measurements is that you have to take a Fourier transform of your whatever exacts measurements you have, and then what it gives you, it gives you peaks like this. And what this is telling you that from strontium atom there is a shell of atoms which is at this particular distance, there is another shell of atoms which is at this particular distance, and then this is the third shell. So such kind of shell information you can obtain, and from that shell information you can actually calculate the bond lengths. So we calculated the bond lengths of SrO, strontium. What is the bond length between strontium and oxygen, and it matched fairly well with the results we got from XRD. And you will see this, that we are using several techniques to verify the same thing. Okay, so some might say that why we are doing this redundant exercise. The exercise is not redundant because no one technique can give you absolute confirmatory answer, because there are several ways of analyzing the same data. How do you confirm that whatever analysis you have done is correct or not? So that is why generally you use complementary techniques to check that. So Raman spectra we measured. Raman spectra, as I told you, it gives you information about bond strength and things like that. And in this Raman spectra, there were several peaks. Okay, but in some peaks there was absolutely no shifting with lanthanum, whereas in some other peaks, as you can see here, that we observed some blue shift. Okay, now again we don't have so much time to go into the details of all these things, but the major conclusion that we drew from all this was that whenever we were talking about the bond strength of tin and oxygen, that bond strength was increasing with lanthanum doping. Okay, and that is what we expect whenever that bond length is decreasing, which is the result which we got from XRD. Okay, so this is again in accordance with whatever results we have been deriving since we have used XRD. Okay, so it is telling you, this blue shift is telling you that there is some increase in the strength of tin oxide, whenever we were getting vibrations related to the octahedra or related to something else, there was absolutely no change with lanthanum doping. So this was again telling us that it is just the rotation of the octahedra and nothing much is changing inside the structure. And the same result we got from FTIR also. We measured that particular mode which was related to tin oxide, and when we observed that, we saw that with doping that mode itself was again getting shifted towards higher and higher energies. So XPS, in case of we measured the XPS, and in this I will again, as I said before, I am not going too much into the details of everything, but the main point here is this star that we have shown you. All the peaks we could measure for strontium 3p levels, 3p half and 3p 3/2, that levels were there and they were as expected, but we got this particular shoulder kind of structure. And what this shoulder kind of structure is showing is the plasma oscillations which I mentioned previously. So these plasmon oscillations are again an indication that when we are doping lanthanum inside our material, it is giving rise to conductivity inside the material. I will show you again later on that what is the origin of that conductivity. But we also measured the XPS at strontium 3D levels. We did not see any changes in this particular XPS spectrum. So it is telling that the 3D levels are not getting disturbed by lanthanum doping. Oxygen is very, very important here. Oxygen, if it is present at the lattice site, it does not contribute any conductivity to the material. But if you have oxygen vacancies, then what happens is, because oxygen has two negative charge, whenever it goes away, it leaves its lattice position. It leaves the lattice position in the form of a neutral atom. So what it does is, it donates its two electrons to the solid and it increases the conductivity of the solid. Therefore, oxygen vacancies are very, very important from the conductivity point of view. And from XPS, what we found here was that we had two kind of oxygen environment. One was oxygen present at the lattice site. Another one was oxygen present, the presence of oxygen vacancies. And what we found with lanthanum doping was that these oxygen vacancy contribution was increasing with lanthanum doping. So again, it indicates that they are donating electrons inside the material. And what these donated electrons do? Some of them go for conduction, but some of them, what they do is they reduce tin from their 4+ state to their 2+ state. So to gain information from that particular point of view, we measured the 3D XPS spectrum at the tin site for the tin element. And we found the same thing. We found that there were contributions due to tin 4+ and tin 2+. And as we were doping the material with lanthanum, the contribution due to SN2+ was increasing at the expense of SN4+. We calculated the various percentages. So this is the percentage of SN2+ that we got. That the percentage was increasing by almost 7% with lanthanum doping. Now we want to get information about the band structure also. Band structure is very, very important for these semiconducting materials. So you can gain information about the Fermi energy and the valence band maximum by what is known as valence band spectra, which is shown over here. So Fermi energy, we know from the experiment, we know that this is where the Fermi energy is lying, as you can see with the vertical line. And to calculate the valence band maximum, we extrapolate this line and this line. And wherever we get our intersection, that gives our valence band maximum. So you can see that the Fermi level is 2.6 electron volt above the valence band here and 2.8 electron volts above the valence band here. We will use all this information to construct our electronic structure. We calculated this, we measured this UV visible spectroscopy also. And in this case, what the important thing that you can notice here is, you can see that the optical range is from this 400 nanometers to 800 nanometers. And for the undoped sample, for the pure SRSNO3, you can see that there is considerable absorption. But as we move it with lanthanum doping, the absorption has reduced considerably. Okay, why that is the case? That is again related to the reduction in the tilting of the optoelectrode. We calculated the band gap also, and those band gaps are listed over here. There is a decrease in the band gap. And what we did was, we used all this information to construct the band gap. And the overall picture is shown over here. On the left is the undoped sample. On the right hand side, we have the 7% lanthanum doped SRSNO3. Okay, so from this picture, what you can see here is, the important point here is that the Fermi level is getting shifted in the upward direction. The conduction band is getting shifted in the downward direction. And the energy separation between your Fermi level and the conduction band minimum has decreased by 0.3 electron volt. Now you might say that this 0.3 electron volt is not too much. But when you consider that the carrier concentration in the conduction band is related to the exponential of the energy difference, then this slight change in 0.3 electron volt can lead to a drastic change in the formation of n-type semiconductor. Okay. And I hope you remember this from plus 2 and your BSc, that whenever the Fermi level is shifting towards the conduction band minimum, it favors more and more formation of n-type semiconductor. So I don't have much time left actually, so I will just try to wrap up whatever we have done in the form of thin films in the next 5 minutes. Okay. So in case of thin films, what happens is that what we did was we took those bulk material and then we deposited thin films of those. Okay, because if you want to use it in the form of devices or anything, you should study, you should always study its thin film properties. Yes, question?
No, sir.
So we deposited them in the form of thin films using pulse laser deposition, and from XRD we did not get any additional peaks or any kind of impurity phases. That means that we deposited the material that we wanted. The peaks are indexed here. Whatever peaks are not indexed, all those peaks were found from the substrate. We calculated the strain in the films using this XRD, and what we found here, as you can see, is that the lattice strain is decreasing with the lanthanum grouping. Okay. So this decrease in strain is very, very important because it enhances the transport and the optical properties of these materials. We deposited the films, we saw the AFM, we saw the surface of the film, and what we found was that as we are doping with lanthanum, the films are getting smoother and smoother. Okay, and which is very, very important to make heterostructures of these films. Now this resistivity we could not calculate for the bulk samples because you need to make those bulk samples compact enough to get some kind of conductivity. So that was not possible for bulk samples, but we did it for the thin films, and we observed 7 orders of magnitude change in the resistivity with lanthanum grouping. Now this is a huge change, and at room temperature we found that the 7% lanthanum doped film was having a conductivity of around 50 milliohm centimeter, and which is exactly what we wanted. Exactly in the sense that the order of magnitude should be of the order of milliohm centimeter. That is what we found. We fit all these curves with this theoretical model, which is known as the variable range hopping model, and we saw that whatever conductivity we are getting in these thin films, they are actually due to hopping from one side to another. And this gave us information about the microscopic origin of the conductivity that we are observing. This is again very, very important, as you can see that the transmittance is almost 90% for the doped samples only, you can see. And in the case of undoped sample, as you can see from this black curve, that the transmittance is actually less. Okay, and the transmittance is increasing when we are doping it with lanthanum, which again shows that the lanthanum doping is very, very good for optical properties also and for transport properties also. Okay, so that is all that I wanted to share with all of you. These conclusions are some conclusions are listed here. For the bulk sample, we have shown that we have reduced the tilting. That tilting enhances its conductivity, it enhances its optical properties. Yes.
Sir, one more question is here. Recently, it was observed that perovskite solar cells are efficient than titanium oxide or zinc oxide. So, are these commercially available for energy applications?
No, they are not commercially applicable. Not commercially available, because to make them commercially available, generally what happens is that you have to simplify the production technique. Okay, so that they can be used on an industrial purpose. What we, for example, are doing is that we are using some specialized techniques which require some very specific instruments to create. But for industry applications, because they want to generate in hundreds, thousands, millions, and that therefore you have to streamline the production process. Okay, some perovskite based solar cells are available, but they are generally very expensive because the synthesis technique is expensive. So in that sense, they are not available. You can use them if you want to, but you have to pay more money.
Sir, one more question is here. Yeah. Sir, XRD, SEM, TEM, XPS, these techniques I had also used. But VBS, one technique, one data you have shown now.
Valence band spectroscopy. That you can perform at the beam line wherever you are performing XPS. Generally, they have some low energy beam lines, and there you can perform this.
Is it software? Some kind of software?
No, it is not a software. You have to measure. These are experimental results.
Okay. technique, yes, sir. BBS is a technique.
Yes. What it does is that it probes the valence band. That is why it is known as the valence band spectroscopy. So if you can see that what happens in case of valence band spectroscopy, let me just show you the results. You can see that the binding energy, you are going from 0 electron volt to 14, and total range is around 16 electron volts. Okay. Whereas in case of XPS, what happens is that you are dealing with 500, 550, 600, and even more or even less electron volts. So the difference in energy is very large. Okay. Therefore, what you have to do is you have to use a different kind of beamline for XPS and a different kind of beamline you can use for valence band spectroscopy. If you want to see more details of BBS spectra, then.
So, ये in situ तरह का कुछ है, in situ kind of कुछ
है। नहीं नहीं, beamline जैसे अगर आप
during beam exposure, जो IOAC में होता है, during beam exposure से ये।
नहीं नहीं, IOAC में जो beams होती हैं, वो beam होती हैं ions की beam है वो। Those are ion beams. But here we are using beams of X-rays. Such X-ray beams are available, for example, in Indore at RR Kent.
Okay, sir. Done.
So I just briefed that what we are talking about bulk, and in bulk we have seen that the electron doping is due to lanthanum and due to the oxygen vacancies both. Okay, and we also obtained this band structure, which was very very important. In case of thin films, apart from all the other details, we have seen that these thin films have very good transport and optical properties also. Okay. So that is all from my side. I have tried to finish it within time. I hope I have overshoot by 4 minutes, I guess.
No, sir. You can take extra time if you want.
No, I always try to stick to time. So these are the publications. One of Yogesh paper is under review, and one he has already published in Ceramic Internationals. Okay, and these are the books that you can follow from where I have taken the discussion. So thank you everyone. That is all from my side.
Participants, if you want to ask anything.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. Here is Dr. Satveer Singh from Guru Nanak Dev University, Amritsar. So, yeah, sir, you have presented very wonderful and basic information regarding perovskite structure-based transconductor materials. So, yeah, as we are working on ZnO-based dye-sensitized solar cells with the help of IIT Roorkee, so that we have a basic idea from the perovskite, so that I put some of these questions to you in the debate. Thanking you, sir.
बेसिक नॉलेज ऑफ द पर्वोस्काइट. And there is one more talk related to perovskite is also, you know, I guess on 1st October by Dr. Nupinder Singh for the participants.
Okay. Okay.
Information for the participants. So, I think sir, Abhishek sir, sir, thanks yaar.
Acha, thank you. So, is the session over then?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you everyone. Thank you. Very much. It was very nice to interact with you all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.